probably not you guys.
May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Sorry about, start off with a sorry for last week. My microphone would not stay on, batteries apparent, I pushed them too far, and I did not have two extra ones up front. Now I have two extra ones up front again, and if that happens, I will be able to change it. A few announcements for us this morning. Porch takes up the sign-up sheets are in the hallway. It's a couple weeks away. And this coming week, there's lots of things going on. Rebecca Circle, Monday at 1 o'clock. Tuesday is Election Day. And we also have AA at 8. Wednesday is Kids Club and Youth Group. And Thursday is Staff and Pastor Parish Relations Committee and Bible Study. Next Sunday will be the Sunday that we take our special offering for Operation Christmas Child. And the following Sunday, the 15th, will be the last day that we can bring in boxes. It does cost $7 a box to ship. Some people bring that $7 in with their boxes. Some people don't. But last year we sent 120 boxes, and it was, somewhere, 800, almost not. A little over $800 for it. Wonderful ministry, and that's what the videos have been showing over the last couple of weeks. Those of you who have been here to see all the assorted videos, you've seen how they impact people, and the shoeboxes make a huge difference in their lives. If you've been in one of our Sunday school classes, they actually shared a story of a girl named Daniela, and we'll probably talk about it a little bit either next week or the week after in Children's Month. Are there any announcements I'm forgetting this morning? Okay. Well, if not, then I'll hand it over to Don, who's filling in for Carol this morning for birthdays and anniversaries.
Thank you.
Backs of our bulletins to our prayer list would be you have any updates on ones who are on the prayer list or joys or concerns we'd like to share this morning? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I have a couple. My dad had a skin graft a couple weeks ago, and graft is still alive, so that's the good news. Bad news is that it was infected, so I'd like prayers for the clearing of that infection, please. And also, a friend of mine went to the hospital with broken leg over in Henry County, Lorraine Sherman, and her service dog is under the weather, needs some prayers for healing. That's for the older. And if anyone knows of anybody who would like an older, retired service dog, she is a black lab, and she's very good with cats, dogs, kids, anybody. She's a wonderful dog. But she's blind herself, and so she can't really guide Lorraine anymore.
Okay. Okay. Well, I know Leah's served well and taking good care of her. So.
She's 10 years old, so it's time for her to retire.
Okay. Would there be any others this morning? Yes, ma'am. Which you're all in the same area here. Whoever wants to go first. Yes.
Grady's cousin, his wife is not having a baby this week. He was a month early, and he's having breathing issues. And so every time he stops breathing, he has to stay in the hospital for 5 more days. So they had another episode this morning. So we just like prayers to get him to be breathing on his own properly.
Okay, what's his name?
His name is Jacob. And the last name is Deeds. D-E-E-D-S.
Jacob Deeds. We will keep little Jacob in our prayers. That his lungs and everything will start working better.
Thank
Yes, who wants to go next? Yes, ma'am.
I'm taking home Friday from the hospital. As soon as they can figure out exactly how to get him stented, they will have to do that.
Okay. Well, we will continue to keep LJ in our prayers that they get everything figured out for him. Yes, ma'am.
Ben's having surgery.
Okay. We will keep that in our prayers that everything goes well. The doctors do everything they're supposed to do. Would there be any others this morning? Okay. Well, if not, let's go to the Lord in prayer this time. Dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the sunshine. We thank you for the warmth holding on. We thank you, Lord, for the feelings we felt as we gathered together. We thank you for the extra hour of sleep or play, whichever we used it for, Lord. We just thank you for all the ways that you've been with us in the past week. And we praise you, Lord, for your promises to be with us through the week to come. We come before you this morning, Lord, and we lift all these ones up that are on our hearts, and especially these ones that we've mentioned this morning. We ask, Lord, that you will be with them. We ask, Lord, that you will be with little Jacob, that you will touch his lungs and his little body, and that you will help him, his lungs, to finish developing properly, and that you will help his breathing to become good. We ask, Lord, that you will keep his parents in your hands and all those who worry about him, and that you will allow them to know that he and they are in your hands and that you are caring for each of them. Touch his little body. We also thank you, Lord, for Leah Lorianne's service dog. We ask that you will continue to watch over Lorianne and Leah, and that you will help Leah to find a new home, and that you will help Lorianne to find a replacement that will be as dependable as Leah. We thank you for each of them, and we ask, Lord, that you will take care and watch over each of them. We thank you also, Lord, for Hal and how his one procedure has gone well, but we also know, Lord, that there's other problems. We ask, Lord, that you will touch the infection that's in his foot, and that you will help it to heal, and that you will help him to be able to get back home and to be able to do the things that he likes to do. Please, Lord, touch his foot and allow all the processes that the doctors and nurses put him through to be able to be good for him. Watch over him, Lord. We also ask the same for LJ, Lord. We know he's had some struggles trying to get his procedures done, and we just ask, Lord, that you clear all the way, that you allow all things to go well, and that you help the doctors and the nurses to find ways to take care of him, to watch over him, and to help to be able to take care of the things that they need to do. Watch over him, Lord. We also bring Ben to you, Lord, and we ask that you will be with him. That you will help the doctors and nurses to do all the things that will allow tomorrow to go well for him, and that you will give him a quick recovery. We ask, Lord, that you will be with all those who worry about him as all these things are going on, and that you will be in the day. We thank you, Lord. We pray, Lord, for the others who are on our prayer list. We thank you for them. We pray, Lord, that you will be moving in their lives, that you will know every situation, that you will have the very best for them, and you will pour that best out upon them. Help them to be able to see you and be able to give you the praise for the ways that you are with them. Be in every situation. We also pray, Lord, for our communities. We thank you for them. We thank you for the peace, the safety, and the security that you pour out upon this land. And we thank you for it to be a good place for our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren. We ask, Lord, that you will go with them all the places that they go, that you will watch over them and care for them, and that you will keep them in your hands and help them to know your love. We pray, Lord, for our neighbors. We thank you for them, Lord. We thank you for the opportunities that you allow us to be you to them. And we give you praise and thanks, Lord, for the opportunities where they are you to us. We just ask you will continue to keep your peace on this land, and that you will continue to speak to our leaders, that you will help them to hear your voice and to follow your will and to do good for your people. We pray, Lord, for the upcoming election on Tuesday, that, Lord, your candidates will win, and that you will guide this land, that you will guide the issues, that you will be in all that goes on, Lord, and that you will help this land to be true to you. We thank you, Lord, that you allow us those determinations, and we thank you, Lord, your hand in guiding our lives and blessing this land. Please continue to keep your hands upon it. We pray, Lord, for those who are in the military. We ask, Lord, that you will be with them, that you will watch over them and care for them, that you will surround them with your shield of strength and protection, and that, Lord, you will help them to carry out the many difficult tasks that they are called to perform. We ask, Lord, that you will bring them home safely to us, and we pray, Lord, for those who do not come home safely. To those who are healing, to those, Lord, who are injured, we ask that you give your healing, both in body and in spirit. And to those, Lord, who do not come home, we ask, Lord, that you will be with their families, that you will allow them to know that they and their loved ones are in your hands, and that you are watching over them, and that you have them all. We pray also, Lord, for those who are in the nursing homes. We ask, Lord, that you will watch over them and care for them, that you will allow their days to be good, and that you will put smiles upon their faces and joy in their hearts. We also ask, Lord, that you will bless all those who care for them and all those who visit them, that you will allow the halls to be places filled with your laughter. We thank you, Lord, and we give you praise for all things, and we pray all these things in your Son Jesus' holy name.
Turning your manual now to number 364, Cross Your Lips.
Thank you.
scripture, the first reading from Acts, the 11th chapter, and it's actually the first through the 18th verse. I keep getting reminded from time to time that the Jewish people, after Jesus died and raised again, they had a lot of trouble with the idea of Gentiles, people like us, being involved in this salvation. So the lesson here is to be one of the examples. Now the apostles and brethren who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God. And when Peter came to Jerusalem, those of the circumcision contended with him, saying, "You went into uncircumcised men and eat with them." But Peter explained it to them in order from the beginning, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, an object descending like a great sheet let down from heaven by four corners, and it came to me. When I observed it intently and considered, I saw four-footed animals of the earth, and the beasts, creeping things, and birds of the air. And I heard a voice saying to me, 'Rise, Peter, kill and eat.' But I said, 'Not so, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has at any time entered my mouth.' But the voice answered me again from heaven, 'What God hath cleansed, must not call common.' Now this was done three times, and all were drawn up again into heaven. At that very moment, three men stood before the house where I was, having been sent to me from Caesarea. Then the Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. Moreover, these six brethren accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house, who said to him, 'Send men to Joppa, call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, as upon us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, 'John indeed baptized with water. You shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God?" When they heard these things, they became silent, and they glorified God, saying, "Then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life."
In the Great Commission, Jesus said, go to Jerusalem, to Judea, to Samaria, to the ends of the world, and share what I have taught you, and make disciples. It's my paraphrase of our second reading of Acts, chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. That's what Peter was doing. He was going. That's what Jesus told him to do. Told him to go. God, with Bill's reading last week, Peter was in Caesarea, and he was sent by the centurion. They sent for him, and he had this vision. He told him exactly where to go, and he brought Peter back. And Peter had a great time. He saw the Spirit move. He saw amazing things happen. And some other people saw some amazing things happen. How many people try to keep salvation for themselves and themselves alone? That's really all that matters for them. Just me and those I care about. Well, honestly, in a lot of cases, that's how we act. Okay? It's how I act a lot of the time. How important is it that people actually hear Jesus and get to know Jesus? Is it important? Most of us would say yes. That's why we're here this morning, right? Most of us would say yes. Well, do we really believe Jesus that when he said he is the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except through him? Do we really believe that, or do we believe that, well, Buddhists have the equal of a path? Do we believe that Muslims have the equal of a path? Do we believe that Hindus do? Do we believe that there really is a pantheon of gods out there, and we're just choosing to worship the best one of the bunch? That's what they did in Athens. When Paul went to Athens, he went into their agora, and the great teaching place, the great speaking place, and he looked about and saw that there was a God in everything. And the people were so hedging their bets on gods because, well, their gods were evil jerks that liked to play pranks and liked to rape, pillage, and plunder and do whatever the heck they wanted to do. So to cover all their bets and hedge their bets, they even had an empty cubicle that said, "To the unknown God." You gotta make sure you got everything covered, right? You know, it's like, you know, when the lottery gets up over 200 million and you go out and buy enough lottery tickets to make sure you've played every number at least once. You go, "I'm gonna win." If you've ever done that, has it ever helped your chances? Nope. Because there's so many numbers and so many combinations, you can't possibly get them all. Hedging our bets. I think sometimes that's why our churches aren't full. Because we just see Jesus as a way to hedge our bets. In John chapter 14, in verse 1, Jesus says, "I go to prepare a place for you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would not have told you that I go and prepare a place for you. Where I am, there you shall be with me forever." Jesus said that. That's pretty plain and simple. Now, sometimes we think Peter is the only one of the disciples that says really goofy things. Okay? This is Thomas's biggest one. I understand him not believing the others. Right? Come on. You know how some of our friends are. If some of our friends told us something, yeah, come on, we've got to see it to believe it, don't we? We all know people that tell big tales and they want all kinds of fascinating things to be true. Look at the internet. It's filled with false reports and fake things. But Thomas here says something back to Jesus. "Wait a minute, Jesus, we don't know where you're going. We don't know the way." In my Father's house. They know he's not talking about Joseph. They know he's not talking about the place Mary lives. Plain and simple, he's talking about God and heaven. Do we really believe that that is the way to heaven? Sometimes I'm really not so sure. I mean, I think we believe it enough to make ourselves safe and secure. Is that how we believe it? Just enough. It's like when we take communion. Do we want a whole lot of Jesus, or do we want just enough of Jesus to make us clean for the moment? Which is it that we want? Do we want to be safe and secure and just continue doing whatever we want to do? Well, that's children, right? That's what our children want. That's why our children throw tempers and temper tantrums and have fits sometimes, because we actually know what's better for them and we're trying to get them to do what's right. But they live in such a safe environment that they can't imagine what can possibly go wrong. And so they throw a temper tantrum when they don't get their way. Does that describe us? I know sometimes that describes me. And Dev, I want you to notice, Thomas was afraid to say he was the only one that didn't get it. Thomas didn't say, Lord, I don't get what you're saying. Please explain it to me a little better. I'm being thick today. Thomas didn't say that, did he? No, Thomas said, we don't know where you're going. And whenever we're worried about things and we don't understand, we assumed everybody didn't understand, don't we? So we responded, whoa, wait a minute, everybody didn't get that. Where are you going? We don't get it. What he should have said was, Jesus, I don't get it. And we know Thomas didn't get it until after the resurrection. So I was down with Thomas. He had his doubts the whole time. 3.5 years of traveling with Jesus, and he had his doubts. So with you having your doubts and me having my doubts, we shouldn't be so surprised because, well, in all honesty, we've only got stories and things we've seen of him moving. Things we've seen him do. Ways he's been with people, ways he's multiplied good, the ways he's eased pain. That's all we have to go on. Why do we find it so hard to trust one? Do we really believe that Jesus is the only way? Now, I want to talk about Jesus, the only way, and Jesus telling them to go to Jerusalem. We tend to think of Jerusalem as being a faraway city, and it doesn't mean home, does it? Right? We never think of Jerusalem as being home. We think as the other parts of the world, and we're kind of included in that, you know, kind of like as an afterthought, that Jerusalem's important. Judea's important. Samaria's important. You know, those are all the people that have Jewish roots. But Jesus didn't stop there. And that's what he was doing with the story that Don read for us this morning. He was going into all the world. Because all the world needs the Savior. If the other ways were valid, Christians don't need to go to India because they have Hinduism or Buddhism. We just don't need to go. If Islam is right, then we should just leave the Middle East alone, let them all kill themselves, whichever which sect wants to be number one, and just stay away from them because they're all getting to their God the right way. Right? Either Jesus matters and he is the way, the truth, and the life, or he is not. Now, John Wesley really, truly believed that the ways of God was the only way. That you will follow these ways, come hell or high water, and you will wind up in hell. Period. How many of us has ever been able to keep the law? Anybody even keep our modern law? You know, the laws that we keep as a people? No, we don't, do we? Laws make us rebel. Laws show us that we are not able to keep these things. That's why after John Wesley's change, John Wesley no longer believed all that nonsense. He didn't make people sign up for communion anymore because he knew it was a heart thing. And most people, if their hearts weren't right, they weren't going to come forward to take it because they were too terrified to take it because all they had heard was all this hellfire and damnation that was coming down on you because you aren't living right, and not only aren't you living right, you can't live right, so there's no chance for you. That's what Peter was arguing. Peter was talking about grace. Because Peter was talking about that what God has done and was doing was something that can't be earned. We can't be good enough for Jesus' love. We can't be good enough for the grace of God. Because if we're counting on goodness, then we're counting on law. And you better know every bit of it, because Jesus said if you break the least of it, you've broken it all. If you've ever lied once, even a white lie, it's a lie. If you've ever taken something once that doesn't belong to you, It was a theft, plain and simple. If you've ever switched a price tag on something, it's theft. If you've ever just, we can go on and on, can't we? We know the commandments. Yep, never killed no one. Number one is murder. But Jesus said, if you hate someone, you have murdered them. If you slander someone, you have murdered them. It's the same. Pretty harsh standard to stand up to. And he says his Father's house has places for all of us. If it wasn't true, I wouldn't have told you. I wouldn't have gotten your hopes up. Now, was Jesus the one? Was he really resurrected at that point? The song, Because He Lives. Do we have hope? Because He lives, because of what He changed and did yesterday, do we have hope for tomorrow that He really makes a difference? Then what's our excuse for not living for Him in a way that others find it inviting and exciting? Won't always be smooth. Peter got drummed up on charges time and time and time again. He was always getting in trouble with the old ways. Because the old ways weren't good, were they? When you keep people out, when you try to be exclusive, when you say that this is the only way, it better be the only way, right? And it not just better be some way that we're making rules for you to live by. It's grace and grace for all. That's why we can celebrate communion. Because it's grace. God pours every bit of it out upon us as undeserving as we get. I want you to remember something. Think back in your lives. The time you were most afraid of sharing with something, someone, something you did. Think back on that. How terrified you were. How you hid or wanted that to stay hid. Just like Adam and Eve wanted to stay hid from God when they didn't follow the one thing He told them to do. Now I want you to think of each of those times in your life that you felt that way. Because if you're like me, it's been more than once. Now I want you to think of the time that whenever you shared, whenever you asked for forgiveness, that it was blatantly just poured out. That it was just given. That it was said, okay, do better next time. I'm not going to treat you worse. I'm not going to dock your pay. I'm not going to think of you as a liar or a thief or a cheat or a murderer or as any of those things. Think of those moments that you were just shown forgiveness and grace. Now multiply that by 1,000 and ask God. We find it hard to live there because we want to compare ourselves to others. That's what the old way was. I'm better than you, so I'm in and you're out. I'm born better than you, and I'm in and you're out. That's the epitome of the fall in the Jewish way of thinking, of the Sanhedrin way of thinking. Most Jewish people know that it's by faith that Abraham was accounted as righteous. That's what the Old Testament tells us too. That it was by faith, not by law. In fact, Abraham didn't even have the law. The commandments weren't chiseled in stone yet. They weren't given. It was by faith. It's by following God and trying to do what He wants us to do. Now, I understand sometimes we're just too afraid to talk about God. Pray. Pray for those situations where you are in that you really don't think God belongs. Because sometimes that's our workplace. I'll be honest with you. I've worked with some crews of people that were some of the most foul-mouthed, you know, cantankerous, nasty people in the world. And you'd swear the entire crew was God-forsaken. And the longer you worked there, the more you felt God-forsaken. But in most cases, It's just waiting for a God moment. It's just waiting for a moment to be shared that God does something different. Pick on you for a moment, Joni. Joni, as most of you know, she works out at Sauter. And, she actually has a reputation in Sauter as, oh, we're not supposed to use those words around her. Is that a witness? That's an amazing witness, Joni.
It's a challenge.
Yeah. The most amazing part of it is they govern themselves, don't they?
Yes.
They govern themselves because of your witness. We never realize what can happen because of what our witness is. It's just a little. We sometimes think it makes about as much difference as our finger going in that bowl of water and taking our finger out. Jesus said, we're the salt of the world. If we stick our finger in the bowl of water as in our workplace, we should have a little salt left behind, shouldn't it? Because of what Jesus does, if we truly believe. Now, I understand some people cannot speak of their faith because they're introverts. How many people have never said anything in church whatsoever? See, I can't raise my hand even as an example, but you won't believe that. How many people never said anything in church? That it scares you to death to say something in church. You can barely even sing because, well, you know, my voice ain't too good. Makes it even harder if we can't speak up something in church to say something about God when we're out in the world. Most times we don't have trouble with the Lord's Prayer, and yes, we will be getting to that. Because I know I'm getting this look from Don as I'm walking across. Doesn't have to be right there, does it? Does it have to be? Does it actually have to be a part of the service each week? Would you have gone home and done it yourself because I felt cheated? I didn't get that regulation and rule filled in. See? That's how we turn it that way, isn't it? And we've got to watch that because it's just too easy. But yes, if you're an introvert, I understand you not wanting to say things because you really don't think your opinion matters anyway, do you? That's why you're such an introvert. You really don't believe others want to hear what you have to say. So it's not worth sharing. Or maybe what I'm going to share is I'm too afraid to share because I'm afraid they're going to laugh and make fun of me. How many of us remember that feeling in school? Yeah, we all remember that feeling in school. Everybody's had a teacher who said, that was just stupid. Why did you ask that? At least I did. We're all afraid that's what we're going to hear. It's just like whenever I ask for responses, there's, in most cases, not too many horrible responses. Sometimes I am looking for a specific thing. But, you know, God speaks to each of us differently. God did not speak to the other guys that was questioning Peter. Okay? God did not give them that vision. God gave Peter that vision. Because Peter was the one who was going to be going, and Peter was the one that was going to be living it. And that's what Jesus asked us to do. Our Jerusalem's name is McClure. It's Damascus Township. It's Henry County. That is our Jerusalem. It is our workplaces. It's our homes. It's all those things that we, all those places that we find ourselves. That's our mission field, first and foremost. Yes, every time we hear of a tragedy around the world, trust me, the United Methodist Church responds and we can give in so many different ways. That's their job to worry about that. It's our job to worry about our Jerusalem, where we are. Now, I ask you again, what do you do with Jesus? Do you believe that he is the way, the truth, and the life? And if you do, what difference does that make? And if you do and you don't, can't say it with joy, how can you get it to be able to be said with joy? Because that's what he wants to do, is free us from joyful obedience. The only thing I can tell you is pray. John Wesley fought prayer when he came back from the Americas. He fought it hard. He didn't want to talk to God. He was hiding. He was broken. He was miserable. And he wanted nothing to do with God. And his brother Charles drug him to that prayer meeting. He didn't want to go. He didn't want to sin. He didn't want to hear somebody talk about some book in the Bible. And this is a man that had a PhD in the Bible, in the Greek Bible, in all of it. He wanted nothing to do with it. And then his heart was strangely warmed, and it was different. Everything was different. It was no longer, you didn't sign up for communion, you didn't take. Oh, by the way, how many people here signed up for communion before Wednesday? Anybody? I know, you don't have to anymore. Because John Wesley's heart was warm. You had to come in and sign up for it. And if he didn't, he turned you away. That's what got him tarred and feathered and sent out of Georgia back to England. The Lord's table is open for all who earnestly repent of their sins, who seek to live in grace and peace with one another. That's where it starts at. It's open to all. Doesn't matter how rich you are, how poor you are, how big you are, how small you are, how smart you are, how stupid you are. It don't matter. And that's why Wesley's heart was warm, because even his sins were forgiven. Is that what we don't believe, that we really can't be forgiven? We've done things that are so bad that God won't forgive them? No such thing, people. No such thing. The only thing that is unforgivable is saying that God does not exist. And if you die in the state of saying God doesn't exist, there's no more chances. But we get a chance every day to praise God and to give it to Him and to live it for Him. I ask, what do we do with Jesus? Let us pray. Dearest Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We give you praise for all the ways that you move, for all the things that you do. We thank you for putting us into our Jerusalem. We thank you, Lord, that you call us to love others. We ask, Lord, that you help us to do so. But most of all, Lord Jesus, we ask that you help us to trust you. To trust that you are the way, the truth, and the life. That you help us to feel that in our hearts, allow our hearts to be warmed, and so that we see you and others in that different light. Take away our fears, replace them with your strength. Take away our sins and make us clean. Allow us to know that even ours are forgiven. And allow us to give you praise. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. If you would, let us turn to page 7 and start our liturgy for communion this morning with the response to the word, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly seek to repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be in
obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
As forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Prophets, and so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, We praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word, the Holy Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, and broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. This morning we are once again serving by intention, where I will rip off a piece of bread and I will hand it to you and you will dip it in the cup. By some weird chance you try to eat it first, go ahead, eat it. You've got another piece of bread, okay? Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit, to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our closing hymn, 395. I hope everybody will get a chance today, to take time to be home.
Keep you in his peace now and for all your days. Amen.